Brunch packet number three. Number one, the square root of a number is between 5 and 6. Which of the following could be the number? So we've taken the square root of a number. We know that square root of 25 does give us 5. The square root of 36 gives us 6. The square root always asks the question, what times itself gives us that number? What times itself gave us 25? That's going to be 5. And so on. What times itself gives us 36? And that's going to be 6. So that's going to be in between 25 and 36. It's going to be the number 31 that's in between 25 and 36. So if we take the square root of 31, let's just double check it. Taking the square root of 2x squared, 31. That's 5.5677. That is between 5 and 6 for the square root of 31. That is, the square root of that number is between 5 and 6. Number 21, which label could replace A in the diagram below? So if you remember that the whole numbers, that's going to be a part of the integers. The integers are positive and negative whole numbers by definition. So the whole numbers, that's going to be 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4, and so on. Just separated by 1, a difference of 1. And then for the integers, that's going to be positive and negative whole numbers starting at 0, 1, 2, 3, just like the whole numbers. But then in the other direction, negative 1, negative 2, and negative 3. And then also, this could be the rational numbers. And if you remember, rational numbers are any numbers that can be written as fractions. Can whole numbers be written as fractions? Sure, they can. Can integers be written as fractions? Sure, they can. But rationals also include decimals and fractions. And so because whole numbers are rationals, we could also say that A would be rationals as well as integers. So let's circle B. The answer is rational numbers and integers, that A could potentially be within the real number group. Number three, which is the, by the way, real numbers also include the irrationals, but they would be off to the side because they are not included with the rational numbers, of course. Number three, which of the following shows the number below written in standard form? So we could move this decimal 4 places to the left. If it's negative exponents, left is going to be if you have a negative exponent. So we will move left 4 places from this spot right here. 1, 2, 3, 4 empty loops do get zeros. How many empty loops do we have? 1, 2, 3. We need 3 extra zeros. So 0.000, then 24072. Notice the decimal is now here for answer choice D. Number 4, a cell phone company charges $40 for the phone. Plus a monthly service charge of $25. The equation below describes the cost Y after X months. So Y equals 25X plus 40, which is true of the relationship between X and Y. So for linear, you need a constant rate of change. Is there a slope, a constant rate? Yes, this is a slope of 25. Since there is a constant rate of change going up 25 for everyone, then we know that this is definitely linear. Is it going to be proportional? So we know we're checking on linear. So yes, definitely linear. So we can eliminate C and D. Is it proportional? Proportional means that the y-intercept is going to be 0. It must go through the origin. 0, 0. So the y-intercept must equal 0 for B in this case. The M is 25, or you could say K if it was proportional, but it's not because the y-intercept is 40, not 0. Therefore, it is non-proportional, making the answer B. Going to number 5 on the next page. Up at the top here, the table below represents a linear relationship. So they've already told us it goes up at a constant rate. What is the y-intercept of the line? So we could find that rate of change, and let's do that because that's very important. We need delta y over delta x. What is the change in y? From 4 to 7, that's plus 3. From 2 to 3, that's going to be plus 1. So that's going to be 3 over one for the change in Y. If you could see that, that's the three. And the change in X, that plus one that goes on the bottom. Three divided by one is three. So for every three along the Y, the change is one on the X. So we could backtrack. We could go back one and one, three and three. Let's go through using the slope-intercept formula, y equals mx plus b, and choose a point. In this case, I'm going to choose 2, 4, and I already have a slope of 3. M does equal 3 in this case. So I will use m to be 3, x to be 2, y to be 4. What do I not know? I do not know b, so we'll bring down plus b, the y-intercept. The y-intercept is the letter b in this case. My y that I've chosen, that's going to be 4. I'll substitute that in place of y. The m that we found was 3 multiplied by x in this particular point, which is 2. So let's multiply that. 3 times 4, that's going to be 6. So 4 equal to 6 plus b. Then subtracting 6 from both sides, the inverse of a plus 6 is going to be a minus 6 or a negative 6 in this case. What is 4 plus negative 6? That's going to be a negative 2. You subtract and take the sign of the larger number. The larger number is 6. So it's going to be a negative 2 for your y-intercept. Let's put it all together. Well, it just asked for the y-intercept. That is going to be a negative 2. We could have written the equation y equal to 3x plus or minus 2 or plus a negative 2. Number 6, Carlos can type 228 words in 4 minutes. Which equation represents the number of words Carlos types per minute? And we can just go follow that as words per minute, words on top, and then minutes on the bottom. But just recognizing that slope is always going to be the dependent variable. Over the independent variable. And that's going to be the words, because the words do depend on the number of minutes. So let's go ahead and substitute now. The words were 228. And the minutes, that's going to be 4. And if we divide that, that is going to be 57. So for my slope, that's going to be 57 in front of x, because it is y equals mx plus b. But this is a proportional situation. So it's actually y equals kx. The y-intercept is going to be 0. He doesn't start with extra words. He's only going to start at 0. So that's going to be y equal to 57x for this proportional situation. And the answer is going to be C. Number 7, what is the length of the third side of the triangle below? We're going to use the Pythagorean theorem and recognize that the longest side is always going to be C. So C is going to be 78. We could use a squared plus b squared equals c squared. If you're familiar with c squared minus b squared equals a squared, you could use that as well. But let's just stick with this structure here. That's going to be 78 to the second. We need to make sure that c is 78. Then I will go ahead and use this for a and this for b. You could use either one. So that's going to be 78 squared plus a squared. I shouldn't have used 78. That's 72 right there. 72 for that shorter side, that leg that's adjacent to your right angle. So 72 is B. And let's go ahead and calculate that. 72 to the second, that's 5,184. So we'll say A squared plus 5,184 equal to 78 to the second power. Remember, the X squared button is right here. Pressing enter, we get 6,084. And now to solve, we will subtract 5,184 from both sides. So 6,084 minus 5,184, that will be 900. So we'll say that a squared is equal to 900. We can't leave it like that, though. We have to take the square root. For the exponent of 2 to go away, we need to take the square root. The square root lifts off that squared, and we have a equal to, and what's the square root of 900? We'll press second, x squared, then type in 900, pressing enter, we get 30. So A is equal to 30. The missing side of our right triangle right here for A is 30. All right, number 8, triangle ABC and XYZ below are similar. How many units long is XZ? So knowing that they are similar, that means we could use a proportion. The sides are proportional in a similar situation. Same shape, different size. And let's just go ahead and go with small to big, small, big. Just labeling those two. And then on the small and the big side, they do need, the AB does match up with X and Y. AB matches up with X and Y. So AB is 2, X and Y is 6. So 2 is to 6 as AC is to XZ. So I do get to use 1.5. Notice I put that on the top with the small. And then XZ, I don't know. So I will simply place an X there. Let's cross multiply. You could find a pattern if you like, or just simply cross multiply. 2 times X, that's going to be 2X. And then 6 times 1.5 is actually 9. We will divide both sides by 2. And 9, half of 9 is 4.5 in this situation. They didn't have units there. You could write 4.5 units. And that is the X from X to Z. So XZ, line segment XZ on that triangle, does equal the 4.5 units. All right. Looking at number 9, a cylinder in an engine has a height of 6.5 inches and a diameter of 4.8 inches. The engine has 6 identical cylinders. What is the volume of all of the cylinders in the engine? So we need all 6. And they gave us a formula, V equals BH. That is on your formula chart. We know that on this cylinder in particular, that is going to be a diameter of how far across? That's going to be 4.8 from edge to edge through the center. So that's going to be 4.8. We do need to cut that in half because in our formula, we're not going to use the diameter. We are going to use the radius. Let's break this down. V equals BH. The B stands for the area of the base, if you remember. And so we need the area formula for the base. And the base is a circle on the bottom of this. So we will use pi r squared in place of B. So we will write this as, in place of B, pi r squared, then h. Let's substitute. We're going to use 3.14 for pi. Notice your answer choices. It does tell you to use 3.14 for pi. And your answer choices do not have pi involved. We're not using pi as a symbol. And then half of 48, that's going to 4.8. If you divide that by 2, will equal 2.4 for the radius. So our radius is 2.4. We are going to square that because the pi r squared, that formula does call for that. And then it tells us that the height is 6.5. So let's use our calculator to find that. Let's go ahead and multiply that as 3.14 times 2.4 squared times 6.5. And that gives us 117.56. Notice your answer choices are rounded to the nearest hundredth. So that's going to be V equals 117.56. And before you start circling C, know that it does say that there are 6 identical cylinders and we need all of them. So we do need to multiply this times 6, and that will give us 705.36. If we rounded, you could probably just use this. If we did 117.56 times 6, that would give us a 705.36, depending on how you rounded. But the answer is D for those 6 identical cylinders. Number 10 in the diagram below, what is the measure in degrees of angle P? So notice that this is 180 degrees for a straight line. It's a straight angle. And right next door, 263, is this angle right here. So if I wanted to find that angle that's adjacent to 63, I will simply subtract 180 minus 63. That's going to be 117 for this angle here that's next door to 63. And then notice also that this angle P is interior to the parallel lines. These are parallel lines. I have two arrows indicating that they are parallel lines. I've got a transversal that cuts through those parallel lines. And then because of that, because there is an interior angle and then an exterior angle on the same side of this transversal that cuts through the parallel lines, we could say that these are corresponding angles, and we know that corresponding angles are congruent. So that means that if this angle is 117 degrees, that is also 117 degrees. And the angle P is 117 degrees because corresponding angles are congruent. Number 11, Maya has a roll of wrapping paper. The area of the paper on the roll is 850 square inches. Maya needs to wrap a gift box that is 12 inches long and 16 inches wide and 15 inches tall. She cuts pieces of wrapping paper so that she can cover the box without overlapping any of the paper. How many square inches of the wrapping paper does Maya have left over? So we're going to use the lateral surface area, which is perimeter of the base times the height, and the total surface area, which is perimeter of the base times the height, plus twice the area of the base. We need both. And so it's good to start by drawing the base of this particular prism, and that's going to be a rectangle. Notice it did say that it's going to be 12 inches long and 6 inches wide. We'll go back for the height here in a second, but for a rectangular prism, for this box in particular, that is going to be, again, that's going to be a 12 by 6 with a height of 15. And we're going to start with the base here and find the perimeter of the base. So we'll add 12 and 12. That's 24, 6 and 6. That's going to be 12. So 24 plus 12 is going to be 36 for the perimeter of the base. Remember, the large P, uppercase P, does represent the perimeter of the base. So that's 36. So we will multiply P times, that's 36 times the height of the shape, which we said was 15 inches tall. So 36 times 15 is 540 inches squared. And so we could stop right there if we only wanted the lateral surface area, which would be all the rectangles in this middle section, the front, the back, the left, the right. But we also need to include the top and the bottom, and that's going to be taken care of with twice big B. So we will carry over for P times H, the lateral surface area. We'll write down 540 plus twice the area of the base. The area of the base is going to be right here. For A, that's going to be B times H. Base times height, that's 12 times 6. And we know 12 times 6 is going to be 72. If you can see that, that's the area being 72. So we'll multiply 2 times 72 for 12 times 6, the area of the base. And then we'll add that together. So that will be 540 plus 2 times 72. That gives us 684. For the total surface area of our rectangular prism. So let's go ahead and write that as 684 inches squared for the area of our rectangular prism, but that's not our answer. What did it ask for? It said how much is left over for the wrapping paper if there was 850 square inches on that roll of wrapping paper. So what we will do is simply subtract the 850 and the 684 and see how much is left over. So 850 minus the 684 will give us 166 remaining inches squared on the gift wrapping paper roll. All right, moving on to number 12. A rectangular prism has a volume of 1,101.12 cubic centimeters. A prism has a length of 14.8 centimeters and a width of 9.3 centimeters. How many centimeters tall is the prism? So let's use what they've given us. We still have a rectangular prism. The dimensions are different. We now have, I'll go ahead and redraw a another rectangle for the base since it's a rectangular prism. And recognize that this time we have 14.8 for the base and 9.3 for the height or length and width, if you will. And so we will use for the area of the base, big B is going to be the area of the base times height. We're going to multiply that 14.8 times 9.3 for the area of our base. Let's take a look. 14.8 times 9.3. That does give us 137.64. We will use that for the area of the base. That's big B. 137.64. And then we will also plug in the volume that they gave us, which was the 1,101.12 cubic centimeters. So underneath volume, I could write that. I'm just going to rewrite that right over here. V equal to big B little h and plug in what we know. V in this case was the 1,101.12 equal to big B, which was 137.64 times the height that we don't know. This is multiplication currently. The opposite of multiplication is division. We're going to divide both sides by 137.64. And let's take a look. That's going to be 1,101.12 divided by 137.64. That will give us exactly, if you could see that, got a lot of glare there. That's going to be 8 for the height. So H, when these cancel to 1, 1 times H is H equal to 8 for the number of centimeters, 8 centimeters for our height. All right. Number 13, it is asking for the order these from least to greatest for these decimals. Notice I've got two that are already in decimal form. We know that 1/4, 1 out of 4/4, that's going to be 25 cents, 0.25. So I could rewrite this as 3.25. And then the square root of 10, what does that look like? Second x squared, 10. It's going to be 3.16227766. And so I will just write that. The other three are basically only going to the hundreds place. So to compare those, I could just stack these up. And I rounded that one to the hundreds place. So 3.24. And then 3.25. And then 3.16. So I need to go least to greatest. Out of those, which one's the least? That's going to be 3.12, the next one. The next to smallest is going to be 3.16, then 3.24, then 3.25 for least to greatest. So one, that's going to be this guy. So 3.12 needs to go first. That's going to be either A or B. Two needs to be 3.16. What was that? That was the square root of 10. So that needs to go second. That's the square root of 10 right here. Third was 3.24. That's third. And then 3.25 for number four, which is 3 1/4. The answer is B. Number 14, what is the y-intercept of the graph? Remember, the y-intercept is where our line, or any function for that matter, crosses the y-axis. Where does this line cross the y-axis? Not the x-axis, but the y-axis. Our B, our y-intercept is at 0, 1, 2, 3. B is 3 for the y-intercept. Number 15, in 7 hours, the operators at a call center make 4,732 telemarketing calls. How many calls did the call center make per hour? So we could simply divide those two. But we do want to recognize that to set up our rate of change, we need the dependent variable divided by the independent variable. And in this case, what depends on what? Well, the calls depend on the hours. So we will set that up as calls over the hours and divide the number of calls. That was 4,732 divided by the total number of hours. That's 7. Let's divide and take a look here. 4,732 divided by 7. That is going to be 676 in terms of the number of calls per hour. So let's write it just like that. 676 calls per hour. All right, number 16, an art school charges a materials fee, and that looks like the $25 here, in addition to a fee per class. So if X is the number of classes, defining our variables, the equation below represents the total cost Y of X classes. Oh, they already defined it for us. That was nice. X classes. Y is going to be the total charge with that $25 fee added to the $40 per class, 40 times X. So how many dollars is the fee for one class plus the materials fee? So the materials fee is going to be $25. There's only one class. Since X is the number of classes, we will write Y equal to 40 times the one class plus 25. We know that 40 times 1 is 40. Plus 25 is going to be 65. So the total charges for the 1 hour in this particular case, the one class will be $65. Moving on, number 17, what is the solution to the equation below? We're going to go ahead and move all of the variables to one side. I'm going to choose this side and subtract 2x so that we keep that positive. Not a requirement, but it just helps sometimes. So subtracting 2x, that'll be 8x minus 2x, which is 6x, bringing down the plus 6. Canceling these to 0. 0 plus negative 3 is going to be negative 3 equal to 0, or sorry, equal to 6x plus 6. Now to move the variables, all of the variables to the other side, we will subtract 6 from both sides, and that will give us 6x equal to a negative 9. From there, we know that multiplication, that's 6 times x, the opposite of multiplication is division. We'll divide both sides by 6. Negative divided by positive is negative, so we can eliminate all of those positive answers. 6 will go into 9 one time with 3 remaining. That's 3 6. That does simplify to 1 half. 1 half is the same as 0.5. So for x, we have a negative 1.5 for our answer. All right, number 18, the fees charged by two canoe rental shops are shown in the table. We're going to use this table for 18 through 20. And so we are going to write an equation to represent the situation. There is a certain number of hours rented at which the cost at the two shops are equal. Which equation below could you use to find the number of hours? So let's go ahead and recognize the east side. That's going to be on, we'll just put that over here. And then west will be over here. And we know that X is going to be the number of hours because we don't know them. So I'll define the X to be the number of hours and move on. So from there, just kind of roping that off. It's $10 for east side for the one-time fee, the one-time deposit, plus $20 per hour. What do I do with 20 and the number of hours? I'm going to multiply them. So that's going to be 10 plus 20 times X, the number of hours, 20X. And then they wanted them equal to. So we'll put an equal sign in the middle. West is going to be $25 deposit. That's a one-time fee, plus $15 per hour, 15 times the number of hours, X. So it would be 15X. which is represented by answer choice C, 20x plus 10 equal to 15x plus 25. Moving on, number 19, let X be the number of rental hours. We've done that. Which of the following shows when it costs more to rent a canoe at Westside? So notice right here, West is on this side over here. If I want this to be larger, I will make the mouth eat this side. So I'll rewrite the same equation, but turn it into an inequality by placing the inequality sign eating the west side, because it did say that they wanted, I know this is for number 19, but they did want the west side to be larger. So for this, for west side to be larger, we have this inequality right up here, and we will simply solve and find out what X is. So I'm going to subtract 15X from both sides. That will give us 25. The inequality sign comes down. 10 plus 20X minus 15X is 5X. And then from there, we're going to subtract 10 from both sides. And that will give us 5X less than 25 minus 10. That's going to be 15. And then to finish this off, I'll carry that over into 19. That's going to be 5X less than 15, just bringing that down. Dividing by 5 on both sides, we need to read this. 15 divided by 5 is 3. And notice it did ask, when will West Side be more? That's going to be when X, the number of hours, is less than 3. Notice the mouth is pointing to X. So the answer is C. When the hours are less than 3, then West Side will be more. Moving on, number 20. Nick and his friends agree on a number of hours they will rent a canoe. They find that this rental will cost the same at both shops. How will Nick and his friends spend to rent the canoe? So they need, first of all, we need to know when they're equal. And we pretty much solved this problem and found that X was 3. But just to reinforce that, we'll solve one more time just to know that when it's equal, that X is going to be 3. So again, we subtracted 15X and we got that cancels. We got 25 here, and then we had 5X plus 10, and then subtracting 10 on both sides, that gave us 5X equal to 15, and then dividing both sides by 5, X equals the 3. So again, we got X equal to 3 in this case because we left the equal sign there. And so what does that mean? That means at 3 hours at both East Side and West, we'll have the same charges. But for us to actually figure out what that charge would be, we need to throw substitute the 3 in place of the X to find out what that would be. So for East Side, that's going to be 10 plus 20 times 3. And what is 20 times 3? That's 60 plus 10. That's $70. What about if we were to try that for the West Side? Would it still be the same? That's 25 plus 15 times the 3 for the hours for the West Side. 25 plus, again, that was 15 times X. X in this case is going to be the 3 hours. 15 times 3 is 45. 45 plus 25 is still $70. That means if they did at either place for East Side or West Side, they would be charged $70 for 3 hours. The answer is D. Number 21, what is the solution of the inequality described below? 2/3 of a number is greater than 6 plus that number. So we don't know X, which is the number that they're talking about on number 21. So let's just translate 2/3 of a number. When you hear the word of coupled with the word with a fraction, that is going to mean that you are going to multiply that fraction times what comes next. So 2/3 of a number, that's X. We don't know that. So it'll be 2/3 times X is greater than. We're going to make the mouth eat the 2/3 X because This expression on the left-hand side is greater than. We make the mouth eat that side. Than 6 plus that number, so it'll be 6 plus x. Let's get rid of that 3 for the denominator. If you remember, to make things easier, we can multiply the whole inequality by that denominator, in this case, 3, and that would simplify things. Remember, when we multiply 3 times 2 thirds, that will simply remove the 3, and let's look at why, because if we multiply 2 thirds times 3 over 1, that would simplify, cross simplify 1 and 1. 3 goes into 3. 1 times 3 goes into 3. 1 times 2 times 1 is 2. 2 divided by 1 is still 2. So that would give us 2x after multiplying 3 times 2 thirds x. We need to multiply 3 times everything in this inequality. Otherwise, it will change the meaning of this inequality. So 3 times 6 is 18. 3 times x is 3x. From there, I will subtract 3x from both sides, minus 3x, minus 3x, 2x plus a negative 3x, subtract and take the sign of the larger number. The larger number is going to be the 3, so I'll keep the negative 1x because 2 minus 3 minus 2 is 1, bringing the inequality sign over and then the 18 over as well. And then from there, we need to divide both sides by negative 1. This is negative 1 times x. The opposite of multiplication is division. And notice we did divide by negative. If you remember, for inequalities, when you divide by a negative or multiply by a negative for that matter, the inequality will flip. So x will come down. 18 divided by negative 1, positive divided by negative is a negative. 18 divided by 1 is 18. Our inequality now reads x is less than negative 18. The answer is B for number 21. Number 22, which translation moves a triangle, 6 units right and 3 units down. If we're going to the right, that's going to affect the x coordinate. And if we're going down, that's going to affect the y. If we want to move to the right, that's adding instead of subtracting. That would be x plus 6. And then if we're going down, that's going to be subtracting from the y coordinate. That would be y minus 3. So what would actually move our triangle 6 units right and 3 units down? That would be x plus 6, y minus 3. The answer is A for our mapping for this particular situation, that translation. Number 23, Annabelle's total pay varies directly with the number of hours she works. If she works 4 hours, she earns $100. How much does Annabelle earn if she works 6 hours? Remember, varies directly is the same as proportional. Proportional means that we get to use a proportion. And before we do, let's figure out what K is. Remember, this is a proportional situation, is y equals KX, and then define what K is, our rate. We will put y over x for dependent over independent. And in this case, that coordinate that we have is going to be 4 hours. That was $100. That's x and that's y. So the dependent, that's going to be 100. That will go on top of our fraction for the y. And the independent, the hours, that's going to be 4. So we could simplify that to 25 over 1, $25 for 1 hour, or we could just leave it as $100 for 4 hours. So now we will set up a proportion. We could just plug that 25 in for K and use it on the 6, but we can also set up a proportion. So that would be 100 over 4. Again, you could use 25 over 1. So 100 over the 4 hours. And then what else did we get? We had 6 hours. And in this case, because the hours are on the bottom, I will also put the 6 hours down there as well and recognize that we're looking for the missing y, the number of dollars for 6 hours. Let's cross multiply. 4 times y is 4y. 100 times 6 is 600. And then we divide both sides by that 4. And then y will equal 600 divided by 4 is $150 for that 6 hours. The answer is C. Number 24, max deposits $1,200 into an account that pays 4% simple interest per year. What is the value of his initial deposit after 3 years? So they want the total amount in the account after that 3 years. Remember, this is simple interest, which on your formula chart will read, well, I equal to PRT for the formula for simple interest. P stands for principal. That's the original amount invested. So that's going to be I equal to $1,200 times the rate as a decimal. We have 4% currently. We're going to move the decimal two places so we can use that in our formula. It must be in decimal form, not as a percent. That's going to be 0.04 since there's one empty loop. That'll be 0.04 times that 1,200 times the time in years. That's going to be 3. Let's calculate, but recognize that this is only going to give us the interest, not the total amount in the account. So 1,200 times 0.04 times the 3, that's going to be $144 that was earned in interest over that 3 years, $144. But they did want to know what the value of the initial deposit was after 3 years. So what we need to do is add back the principal for the total amount in the account. We need the interest plus the principal, the original amount that was invested. So that interest was $144. The principal that was invested was $1,200. So as we add those two, that would give us a total of, for our total amount in the account, $1,344 for the value of that original deposit. Now has $1,344 in the bank after $144 of simple interest. 25, a fully inflated beach ball has a diameter of 19.5 inches, and that's a sphere. A ball is going to be the shape of a sphere. How many cubic inches of air are needed to inflate the ball? Notice they gave us the formula for the volume of a sphere, V equals 4/3 pi r cubed. And we will substitute what we know. Did they give us the diameter or the radius? We need the radius. That means this diameter needs to be divided by 2. So 19.5 for the diameter will be divided by 2 to give us a radius. Let's take a look. 19.5 divided by 2 gives us 9.75 for the radius. And we will plug that in. Formula, substitution, and then answer. So 4/3 comes down. We're going to use pi for 3.14 as they asked us to in this particular situation. Sometimes you'll have to leave it in terms of pi, but not in this case. And then the radius to the third power from our formula for the volume of a sphere. And now we can calculate. For the editable fraction on a TI-84, we press alpha, the green button right here, alpha, y equals, then enter. Then 4, arrow down, 3, arrow to the right, times 3.14, times 9.75. And now we need to raise this, the up arrow, the caret right above the division symbol, raise that to the third power. Pressing enter, we have 3,880.5 if rounding to the tenth place. So let's write exactly that. For the volume of this sphere, this beach ball, 3,880.5. And since it is volume, we will write that as inches cubed for all of the cubes that fill up this sphere, this beach ball. That is our volume. Hope this helps. Have a great day.